Hi YouTube, my name's Jeff, and I run a website called vegilcar.co.uk. Today I'm going to be talking about my homemade daytime running lights. Now, straight away, you might ask the question, why homemade daytime running lights? And the simple answer to that is because I couldn't find any aftermarket parts that fitted my vehicle. Now, if you're in a position like that, if you've gone along to eBay or Amazon or any of the other shops out there and had a look for daytime running lights that will fit your vehicle and you can't find anything that you're looking for, this video might be of help to you. Now, my particular vehicle is a Land Cruiser. It's an LC4 2005. It's the 120 series. And if you've got that make of car, this video might be helpful to you. But if you haven't, it still may be of use to you if you're looking to fit daytime running lights and you just can't find anything out there that will work. Now here you can actually see my daytime running lights in operation, and it's a look which I think is quite pleasing. Now I actually achieved this look with these little fellas, and they're called Eagle Eye LEDs, and you can get them on eBay, you can get them on Amazon, and they're surprisingly cheap. As you can see, it is just an LED and it's got a little nut on the back of it. I think it's an M10 thread there. And the whole idea is you drill a little hole, you place your LED through the hole and you tighten the bolt up at the back, just snug enough to hold it in place. Now, there are some requirements. Now, this is the information that I could glean off the internet about where the lights should be positioned. Now, firstly, the lights must be symmetrical, as in they must be the same on both sides of the car. They must be a minimum of 600 millimeters apart, so you can't have them too close together, and that can be reduced to 400 if you drive a particularly small vehicle. They must be 250 millimeters minimum height from the ground and no more than 1500 millimeters in maximum height. The distance from the outer edge of the vehicle must be no more than 400 millimeters, and they must be pointed forwards. Now, why do I talk about being pointed forwards? Well, the whole point is here, you can fit them pretty much anywhere you can drill a hole. So it struck me that most vehicles these days have got these wonderful soft spoilers at the front, and they're just sheets of fiberglass or plastic, whatever you want to call it, and you can easily drill holes in that. It's very simple. But as I say, orientation is forwards, so if you decide that you want to fit your LEDs into your spoiler, make sure that you don't follow the curves of the spoiler, don't go around the edges, otherwise the orientation will be pointing in the wrong direction. Now, here you can see a close-up of an LC4, and as you can see there, there's a little useful void, and that's a fabulous tip for any Land Cruiser guys out there. This void is obviously put there by Toyota with a view to fitting an aftermarket part at some point. And if that part exists, it's probably a fortune, or I've not found it yet. But all that void there is a piece of plastic at the back. Now, underneath that void there is a nice plastic spoiler, or I say plastic, it might be fiberglass. And so if you haven't got these LC4, what would be perfectly acceptable would be to drill a series of holes anywhere you like on that spoiler, and in any pattern that you like, really. But you've just got to be sensible about it, obviously. Now, here you can actually see the back plates that were removed from that void. Now, as I say, perfect for a Land Cruiser driver. If you don't drive a Land Cruiser, that's all right. But you can see all this is it's just a piece of plastic that I've removed from my vehicle. It could be the spoiler on your car. Now, as you see, also, I've drilled a series of holes there, and I did it in a little bit of an L shape, and I decided on 6 holes. It doesn't have to be 6. It can be just 1. It can be 3. It could be 98. I don't know. Probably 98 is not a good idea. But the point is here that this bit becomes about design, really. You can express yourself a little bit in coming up with the shape that you like. You might want to do a little square, you might want to do just a straight line. I just went with this L shape because I found it pleasing. Now, as you can see, 10 millimeter holes, it's no more difficult than that. And then, of course, was just a case of placing the LEDs inside that and doing up the little nut at the back. Now, because I'm me, I decided to put two nuts on the back. One nut holds the light in place, and the second nut is there to tighten onto the first nut so that it can't come undone. That might not be necessary, but it's me. I'm a belts and braces kind of guy. Now, you might start worrying at this point and saying, hang on, what's going on with all that electrics there? And it's not as difficult as it looks. It's just a matter of connecting everything in parallel. Now, what does that mean? Basically, these lights will have two cables coming from them, a red one and a black one. And all the connecting them in parallel means is that all the red ones have got to come together and all the black ones have got to come together. And that is connecting in parallel. That's how difficult it is. But what has to happen, of course, is that all the reds have got to go to a positive connection and all the blacks have got to go to a negative connection, and that will complete a circuit. Let me just say at this point that if you've got absolutely no clue at all about electrics, then perhaps this isn't for you, because car electrics can kill. There's more than enough power in a car battery to zap the living daylights out of you, and it will kill you. So if you haven't got a clue, then maybe speak to someone that has. Daytime running lights are meant to run during the day. They are a very bright light. And as such, because they're so bright, at night, there's usually two options. One, they should be off completely, or two, they should be dimmed. Daytime running lights should not run on full power during the night. It will simply dazzle other drivers, and it's a danger. So what we need is a circuit that's going to cope with that. Now, of course, again, you can buy these kits on the internet, but me being me, I decided to build my own, as I just simply didn't trust the kits that were out there. And it's relatively simple to do if you're happy with a simple bit of electrics, a simple bit of wiring to a relay, or in this case, a couple of relays. Now, I'm going to show you two circuits. One circuit will allow you to switch them off completely, and another circuit will allow you to run a dimmer circuit. Now, here we are with the first circuit, and this one will run the DRLs normally during the day, but once the side lights are activated, it will turn them off. And it achieves this by using two relays. Now, I use 5-pin relays, but 4-pin relays will do. And what you want to always want to be doing is you always want to be using a fuse. Now, I always use a relay straight off the ignition source rather than power a unit from the ignition source, which so many people do. And do not do it. The manufacturers don't do it. You shouldn't do it. Always run a relay from the ignition source and then run a separate power line with a fuse to activate whatever unit you're going to be using. So here you see, if we start at the beginning there with B, that's a fuse, and it's coming in through our ignition activated relay. Now obviously the power can't come in until the ignition is turned on, then the relay closes that circuit and lets the power come down and feed into the relay at the bottom there, and it comes in on line D, as you see, which is the positive energy coming in through those DRLs and grounding through the chassis of the vehicle. So there's a completed circuit and the lights are working perfectly. But the moment you flip on the side light, which in this case is shown as in the diagram as F, what happens there is I've spliced in a connection from the positive on the side light, and that comes along and activates this second relay. Turn on the side lights, activates the relay, turns off the DRLs. Easy as that. Now then, we're going to go into the second circuit now. Now, dimming LEDs can be a bit of a weird science, really. Traditionally, with a bulb, you'd shove a resistor in there and that would dim the circuit. But DRLs are a completely different thing because they use LEDs. And LEDs, to dim them properly, you need a pulse width modulation dimmer. And there are circuits out there to build one of those if you want to. To be honest, I copped out at this point, and I went along to eBay, and I found a PMW dimmer for sale on eBay, and there's dozens on there, and they're really cheap. They're just a couple of pound. And I thought, well, why go to the trouble of building one when someone else has already done it for me? So here you can see the dimmer that I purchased. And as I say, just a couple of quid, it's not worth it. So I decided to incorporate that dimmer into my circuit, and here you can see DRL Circuit 2. Now this one runs normally on the ignition, and once the side lights are activated, the dimmer circuit kicks in, and what that does is reduces the light intensity that comes out of the DRLs, and you can actually manually adjust that setting, as there's a potentiometer built into the dimming circuit, luckily. So that's just a little knob, if you like, and you turn it one way and it goes bright, turn it one way and it goes dim. So you adjust it so it's nice and dim, but you can still see it at the night time. So let's run through this circuit. Now, straight away you can see that there's actually a third relay in here. And please, all you electronic engineers out there, don't write at me and laugh at my terrible circuit diagram. It works for me and I'm happy with it. And I've basically decided that I've got a positive relay and a negative relay, as the dimmer has a positive and negative output. So let's talk this one through. In ordinary operation, during the daytime, on goes the ignition, which closes the circuit on the ignition relay and allows the current to flow through the fuse B right the way down to the positive relay there. And you'll notice that the negative relay is picking up its negative source from the chassis. This powers the DRLs at full intensity. They're on as brightly as they can be. And all of this completely circumvents the dimmer circuit. And that's what we want. Once the side lights are turned on, as in position F on the diagram there, you'll see that both the positive and negative relays are activated. As they activate, both relays go from their normally closed position into a normally open position, and that in turn connects the dimmer into the circuit. So now you can see that the power coming along from B all the way down to the positive relay, it can't go through anymore. It has to go through the dimmer circuit. So now if we look through the dimmer circuit, power's coming from B, bounces through the dimmer circuit, out through the positive, on the dimmer circuit, through the relay, and through the DRLs. And the same, of course, with the negative. So there you go. I hope that makes some sense. It's perhaps not the best circuit in the world, and certainly not the best explanation, but it does work. Trust me, I've been running this circuit now for a couple of years, and without any trouble at all, I might add. I'm very pleased with it. So let's just sum up, why would you want to do this? Why would you want to make your own DRLs? In terms of cost, it is actually very affordable. The whole thing, including the LEDs, relays and the dimmer, came to just about £40, I think. So it is very affordable. But the main reason for doing this is if you can't find an aftermarket part that works for you, if you can't find one that fits your vehicle. As I say, you can, if you can drill a 10mm hole, you can add LEDs to your vehicle, and you can comply with the law in terms of the dimmer circuits or turning them off at night. And that's it. There is more information on this subject on my website, and you can find it at www.vegelcar.co.uk/DRL. Pretty much everything that's in the video here, but written down for you, so it might make it a little clearer. Also, if you have got any questions on the subject, please don't hesitate to contact me, which you can do through the website. I do ask if you wouldn't mind subscribing to my videos, please. I'm very keen on federal motoring. It's environmental motoring. I think it helps us all. And if you subscribe to my videos, it helps me get the message out there. So if you wouldn't mind, I'd be grateful. Thanks very much for listening.